My favorite Frasier is,
if I had to pick one of all of them. Oh boy, I would say.
All right. Drum roll.
I think probably my favorite Frasier episode was.
You bad boy.
When he was having a love affair with his boss.
You dirty girl.
And they kept referring to each other through the show as bad boy and dirty girl.
Dirty girl. Yes! I am a bad boy, aren't I? You dirty girl. Oh, yes.
Oh, no. Is that the on-air light?
Stop talking. You must have hit the switch with your elbow while we were... Stop talking.
Wait, let's try to get dressed while we still
have... Stop talking!
Lusting after a woman that does nothing but grate on my nerves. I can't stand her.
Oh, really, Dr. Crane? Can a man want to have sex with a woman he doesn't even like?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Niles and Frasier are going to have to take complete blame for their lack of success with women, because they certainly don't get it from me.
I mean, it's not that we were overly impulsive or anything, or that what we did was wrong. I just...
This is a mistake.
Oh, thank God you said that. Oh. It's not that last night wasn't very enjoyable, but who are we kidding? You've gotten on with your life, I've gotten on with mine, I've got a new career, I've reestablished relationships with my family, I've got a whole new set of friends for the first time in years. I'm happy. I mean, for us to even consider getting back together, it's just the stupidest thing two people could do.
I meant the eggs. I ordered poached, not fried.
The problem is, his standards for himself are so high that he can't live up to the kind of person he wants to be in a relationship. It's not so much that the women are a problem. It's just Frasier has a problem.
He has so many levels and compartments of his brain that they start to overlap, and he's not quite sure which one he wants to type into. It's like a madman at a keyboard in a computer or something, you know? He's too smart. He thinks he can outsmart people because he's so smart, but of course he can't.
I wish someone would just tell me who this woman is and why we're trying to impress the pants off her.
She's a one-time Boston barmaid who had a nervous breakdown, ended up in a sanatorium where I met her, fell for her, and then was so mercilessly rejected by her that to this day there is a sucking chest wound where once there dwelled a heart. Diane!
We'll see. The proper woman may come along sometime. But Frasier should be a little less hard on himself, frankly, but he's awfully funny when he's not, so.
These women are as inscrutable as sphinxes.
Yes. Through God, all they've done is send us the most veiled, cloaked, cryptic messages. Can't they just give us one clear signal?
Well, I'm off to bed. Niles, are you coming?
Curse these infernal riddles!
Niles!
To pick at each other so specifically, to be so close in terms of, I mean, in the same profession, for heaven's sakes, and using the same ridiculous jargons, that just makes me laugh.
Salami, I'm Dr. Frasier Crane. This is my brother, Dr. Niles Crane, the eminent psychiatrist. Oh,
my brother is too kind. He was already eminent when my eminence was merely imminent.
I think what's great is they capture a lot of what siblings have, which is great closeness, great mutual support, but also competition and envy.
If you didn't believe the characters were real, you wouldn't follow them that high on the absurd level.
Family has the ability to love you more than anyone else can and hate you more than anyone else can, just because the feelings are so intense. It's what makes it inherently comic and inherently dramatic.
If Dad and I get into a Winnebago together, only one of us will come out alive. You've got to come with us.
Frasier, you're my brother. That entitles you to my bone marrow and one of my kidneys. But this is an imposition.
My favorite Frasier is an episode called Travels with Martin. And it's where Martin and the boys and Daphne go on a trip around America in a Winnebago.
Well, you've certainly got this trip well planned, Mr. Crane. Whenever I take a holiday, I'll just grab a fresh pair of knickers and see where the wind takes me.
Niles.
Niles.
Just because they're on a trip like this, both Frasier and Niles almost regress to childhood again. Daddy, Daddy, stop here, stop there. Can we get an ice cream? No, we gotta get there.
Oh, look, a roadside stand. Fresh fruit, homemade apple cider.
Oh,
Dad,
good.
Dad.
As far as Daphne and Niles goes, excuse me.
Yes.
She is everything that he has never seen in a woman before.
What's that perfume you're wearing?
Leave it to you to notice. It's obsession.
No, it isn't. I was just curious.
She smells a just wonderful, like, mix of English countryside and heather and shampoos and scents and bourbon. I don't know.
The Niles and Daphne situation is my favorite, you know, thing to perform, because there's such a true friendship between these two people.
Dum-da, 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 dum-da.
Heart and soul, dum-da, dum-da. I fell in love with you, heart and soul. Dum-da.
Are you in love with Daphne?
Obviously, I love Niles and Daphne. I think that I always get a kick out of that. And it's really fun to know Jane's struggle with how in the world does a smart woman stay oblivious to this, you know? And it's, you know, it's fun because she does it.
You know, I've always played that she knows somewhere in the back of her head, but it's too scary to deal with because he's Niles and he's, you know, posh and he had Maris and money and, you know, what's he doing going for a girl like Daphne?
Here. Take my bumper shoot.
Oh, isn't that nice? Well, at least someone appreciates my mother tongue.
Yes, I've always had an ear for your tongue. Oh, Niles!
My favorite episode is, big surprise, Moondance. Just everything about that episode was so magical. It was like we shot a little fairy tale, you know, there wasn't a dry eye in the house at the end of it.
A four. Two, three.
This is boring yet difficult.
there's no trick to dancing. It's just a matter of coordination. Hell, if you can ride a bike or skip rope or kick a ball, you can certainly...
I had not danced before. Jane is a real dancer. She is a trained dancer. I believe you probably already know she danced with Benny Hill. So when I had to learn to do the tango with Jane, they brought in someone, a dance therapist.
We actually campaigned somewhat to have them dance together because we thought it would be really funny and romantic.
So when they start to move the coffee table, Dan...
It was also the first episode that Kelsey had directed, so it was very special in that way too. But it was just wonderful. We had such a great time rehearsing it.
I'm a dancer.
We just loved doing it.
Now, take me in your arms, Niles, and let the music carry us away.
Thank you. We'll be back in 10 minutes.
It was the first time directing. He was very bold. If you watch that episode, the camera moves, a lot of the camera setups. There's overhead shots where they had to go up into the catwalks with the cameras to film dances from up above. And it was great.
This is the most glorious night of my life.
Oh, mine too.
But it wouldn't surprise me if on the final episode of our 15th year, as we say goodbye, we're doing so at Niles and Daphne's wedding. That'd be great.
We fooled everyone, didn't we?
Oh, we certainly did, didn't we?
I'm surprised it was so easy.
Well, given the right circumstances, anyone can be fooled. Mm.
Oh, some boys go to college, but we think they're all wussies, 'cause they get all the knowledge
and we get all the whoomp.
When I first met Kelsey, we did. We hit it off right away, both just as folks working together, but also as actors. There was something about our style of acting and our approach to acting that just meshed. Kels was a surfer guy growing up. He's very down to earth, very easygoing. Not at all stuck up.
Niles, where the hell did he go?
I'm over here.
Oh, dear God.
His usual breakfast is either turkey burgers and pickles, or tuna. I know for the English that's not that big a deal because of beans on toast and stuff like that, but for us it's really hard to face that kind of a meal.
Well, I don't know what I'm gonna do.
Why is everything so complicated for you?
Oh boy, I would say...
Do you know how frustrating it is to be completely in love with someone, not be able to tell her how you feel?
First date.
I'm sorry.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
Oh my God. Rachel, how long was she standing there?
I don't know. If I'd known Daphne was standing there, I would have said, shut up, Daphne's standing there.
This was one where Daphne had overheard me saying that I was in love with her. But what I didn't realize was she didn't hear the end part. She didn't hear that it was her. She just heard that I was in love with someone. And I panicked and made up a name.
That Phyllis.
Oh, I've never heard that name. That Phyllis.
And then I had to make up this whole date that I was having with this woman. And then Daphne showed up to help cook dinner for this date that I wasn't having.
Oh, Dr. Crane, I thought you were Phyllis.
Daphne is cooking dinner for your date with a fictitious woman. Why not just set a place for the March Hare and the Mad Hatter?
Then I had a chance to have dinner with Daphne, so anyway, I let it go on as long as it possibly could. But I loved that episode.
Because you held me tight and stole a kiss in the night.
Blah, blah, blah.
The thing I love about our scripts is that we have both physical comedy and verbal comedy.
Cherry's Jubilee for dessert.
All right, fine. You flame them. I'll be out to serve them. Niles, all those eels coming. I'm just trimming them now. Oh, no, no. Take them out of the tank. Not till I'm sure they're dead.
Oh, for heaven's sakes.
Although I laugh at it, I've never been fond of slapstick particularly. We have certainly moments of it in our own show, but... And we can even aspire to some true farce at times.
What was that?
Big blue flash. Cherries everywhere.
Kelsey is really the master of this, that he can go from the smallest, subtlest emotion to the biggest pratfall, sometimes in the space of one sentence.
Distressing news, Frasier. Francois gave away our table.
Screw him! There are plenty of restaurants in town. I say we go somewhere we don't even need a reservation.
Thank you, Niles.
You're welcome.
Yes, you know, if we hasten, perhaps we can catch the first idiot, Lucy Gabalon.
I love Frasier and I love America. And people are constantly kind of slagging off America and saying, oh, you know, Americans have no irony, they know this, and da da da. And then you look at Frasier and you kind of go, well, that is a hit sitcom there. And here, it's too sophisticated. No one would have commissioned it. No one commissioned a sitcom about, you know, two effete men who buy posh coffee and Chardonnay.
Excuse me, did I say decaf?
No, you didn't.
Oh, I'm sorry. You know, if I drink the regular stuff, it'll keep me tossing and turning all through my brother's conversation.
They obsess. They do not know how to be simple.
Decaf, Zimbabwe latte.
Is that non-fat milk?
No.
Oh, I hate to be a bother. It's just that I'm watching my fat intake.
Decaf, non-fat Zimbabwe latte.
Oh, dear, is that cinnamon on that phone?
It's like if you gave them a Rolex, they wouldn't just wear it. They'd open it up and take it all out to see how it works and then not be able to put it back together. And then so it'd be useless.
What's the one thing better than an exquisite meal? An exquisite meal with a
but one tiny flaw we can pick at all night.
Quite right. To impossible standards.
The problem is that he knows nothing about anything and is deeply insecure. He knows he knows nothing. So it's all bravado, braggartry, and pretense.
Where did you hang my painting? I'm always curious to know how people live with my work.
Live with my work? I love that phrase. If you would write this way, please.
He is insecure. He's made money. He has a certain amount of notoriety as a broadcaster. And he thinks that is enough to move him into a higher level of society.
Oh, God, I've waited so long for this moment. I'm just going to stand back and let you describe your work. Elegy in Green.
People who really know about painting and buy them and live with them very rarely talk about them. It's like talking about your wife. You don't.
The way you insinuate the palette but never lean on it. You've captured the zeitgeist of our generation. It is the most perfect canvas it has ever been my privilege to gaze upon.
People love to see these two snobby buffoons get pulled down a level or two.
I didn't paint it.
Of course you didn't. You created it. You gave birth to it.
I didn't do anything to it. I never saw this painting before in my whole life.
And you thought I was going to embarrass you.
What we do is we truly try to show a half an hour of life, not a half an hour of badinage. We don't do a half an hour of I'll set you up for a punchline and then you set me up for a punchline. We tell a half an hour story taken out of the life of these people and just hope that the funny parts are funny enough to make people laugh.
How loosely woven is the fabric of our happiness. A tug or two, and it unravels to reveal how empty our everyday lives really are.
And they're the empty nights, accompanied by thoughts of loneliness and death.
You think about that too? Thought it was just me.
Everybody thinks about it.
Do you lie real still and hold your breath and pretend you're in the ground?
No, that's just you.
The writing is so smart. You travel so far in one scene. The definement of the characters. You know, the different voices pop off the page. You don't have to see Roz or Martin above the speech. You know who it is.
When I die, I want it to be on my 100th birthday in my beach house on Maui, and I want my husband to be so upset he has to drop out of college.
I feel Roz has never gone far enough. The writers say to me all the time, we're protecting you, we're protecting you.
You're gonna have to slow down. I'm getting some mixed signals here.
You have these people that analyze every moment of their lives, and it's refreshing to have someone come up and go,
hoo, hoo.
Hello?
He'll make a fart noise.
I can't work for a chick. They're out of control. They are completely ruled by their hormones. Hoo, hoo. It'll never work.
My favorite episode is Ham Radio by David Lloyd.
Bulldog, where's Maxine?
Oh, she's home with food poisoning. It's nothing serious. I think she just wrestled in some bad jello.
Frasier had unearthed an old radio show, and he decides to put it on the air. And he gets everyone involved, and of course, hilarity ensues.
I tried to shake Nigel's alibi, but each witness was adamant. O'Toole.
Faith, and it's true.
Hans.
Your boy.
Miss McAllister.
Oh, busy, yes.
There remained one suspect whose whereabouts had not yet been established. Pippo the Dwarf, a retired circus performer. Exactly. Where were you when the murders occurred, Pippo? Where are you?
I was at the movies.
I think the kid is my favorite.
I want to talk about it. I'm really excited. I'm going to be a mom. I've got a lot to do. I'll tell you one thing, I got to get pronto.
A husband.
Because I had a lot to do in it.
You have an obligation to let this man know that you're having his baby. Miles, do you mind?
I don't know what you two are talking about, but I resent the implication that I have nothing better to do than spy on you like a nosy teenager. I came in for a corkscrew.
Oh, Niles, I'm sorry.
All I could get was she hasn't told the father.
Good, all right, good. Okay, good boy.
Have you mentioned Eddie yet?
Eddie?
Ta-ta.
Oh, and who might this be?
That is Eddie.
Eddie the dog.
Eddie's not a dog. Eddie, or Moose, actually, his name is an actor.
What are you staring at?
He doesn't do anything unless he gets paid for it.
He won't come to read-throughs. He won't even look at a script.
I call him Eddie Spaghetti.
Oh, he likes pasta.
No, he has worms.
I sure hope you don't take a bite out of the other side.
Did you ever see anything sadder than this?
No, I can't say that I have.
I think it's gotten stronger over the years. I think it's gotten stronger for all the cast members over the years. It's really gotten to be a very tightly knit but also sort of subtle ensemble that we really function. It's a well-oiled machine or a really greasy machine or something like that.
To keep the show fun and fresh, it's as fresh as all life can be if you just approach it with a creative kind of frivolity.
I just have two words for you to say to him, Bette Davis.
Oh, well, yes,
Bette Davis. Just...
How nice for her.
We can put a rug over it.
A rug, where a rug doesn't belong.
A rug. Where a rug doesn't belong.
You can see her sneaking through Frasier once in a while. There have been a number of others.
James Mason.
James Mason's never quite occurred because it's just too obvious a change. My favorite Frasier is...
Now, just a minute. This is gonna be so great.
My Father Whose Art Ain't Heaven. That's the title. And it's coming up after the break. See, it's a very happy set. Well, thank you. And that's how we keep things fresh. Ha ha ha.